This is the VOA Special English Health Report. As sure as honey attracts bees, Valentine's Day attracts scientific reports on human relations. For example, in early February, researchers announced new findings about online dating sites. Many of these popular sites say they have a special formula to find the perfect partner. But the researchers say these claims are unsupported and likely false. Lead author Eli Finkel at Northwestern University in Illinois said online dating is a great addition to the ways for singles to look for love. But the study found that so far, there is no scientific evidence that any formula or matching algorithm actually works. The study is being published in the journal Psychological Science in the Public Interest. Now, here is a different question. When do you suppose a female voice is most unappealing to a man? Researchers measured men's reactions to women's voices at different points during their monthly cycle. The study found that generally, a woman's voice is most unattractive to men during her period. All the experiments found that men can detect small changes in women's voices at different points in the menstrual cycle. About 200 college-age males took part in the study. 10 young women provided voice recordings from 4 points in their cycles. These included the times of highest and lowest fertility. The highest is during ovulation, when the body releases an egg for fertilization. The lowest is during a woman's period. The men had a 25% chance of guessing which recordings were made during menstruation. But they chose correctly at least 34% of the time. Finally, one group of men had to choose the voice they found most unattractive. Again, 34% of the time, they chose the so-called menstrual voice. Nathan Pipitone of Adams State College in Colorado led the study published in the journal Ethology. He points out that in other primates, it is often easy to recognize when females are most fertile. But in humans, the effects of hormonal changes are often difficult to recognize. Dr. Pipitone says evolution may have reduced the effects in humans in order to support relationships with just one partner. As he put it, "I think this reflects the shift in the minimization of these cues across the menstrual cycle to lead to one of our most prominent mating strategies, monogamy." Having drastic shifts in females' attitudes and behaviors does not bode well for a pair bonding relationship. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal.
This is the VOA Special English Health Report. Some people act sick to get out of work. Others act sick to get work. For medical actors like Ted Bell, the stage is an examination room with a future doctor, nurse, or other healthcare professional. On a recent day, he was playing a 55-year-old patient with stomach pains that began 3 months ago. He was describing the problem to a nursing student at the University of Maryland School of Nursing. Ted Bell was playing a school teacher. But in a way, he really does teach. He helps future doctors, nurses, and other healthcare professionals learn to work with patients. In real life, Mr. Bell is a retired civil engineer. He now works as what is known as a standardized patient. He stays busy working as one of about 700 standardized patients in the Baltimore, Washington area. Pay starts at $17 an hour. It can go as high as $35 an hour, depending on the project. Becoming a standardized patient does not require medical knowledge. The schools provide the training. Nor does it require acting experience. In fact, standardized patient Tom Wyatt is a professional actor, yet he does not even think of his work with the students as acting. He says, "I use some of the acting skills, but honestly, when it's going well, I'm not really acting, I am reacting. I'm listening to them and reacting naturally and honestly to what they're saying to me and what they're giving me." Standardized patients spend hours training for each of their performances. They have to remember the medical history of the person they are playing and be able to answer questions as if they were really sick. Tom Wyatt says remembering all the patients he has to play and their conditions can be difficult. Especially when I do, you know, sometimes 9 or 10 cases in a week at 3 different hospitals. So they're all completely different. After each session, the standardized patients talk to the students to discuss their performance. That is, the performance of the student. For instance, he recently told one student nurse practitioner, "The things that really stood out for me, your manner was extremely professional, and you were in command at all times. You kind of took charge of the room." The students say they like working with medical actors, and the actors enjoy it too. Ted Bell says the students find the experience very helpful, and that makes him feel good. For VOA Special English, I'm Carolyn Prasuti. Get more news and learn English at voaspecialenglish.com.
This is the VOA Special English Health Report. Heart disease is the world's leading cause of death, yet most cases can be prevented. Doctors say reducing deaths from heart disease will require not only changes in the way people live, it will also require changes in public policy and better public knowledge about differences in heart disease between men and women. Two conditions, coronary artery disease and microvascular disease, can both reduce blood flow to the heart. Experts at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston say heart disease in women is more likely to be caused by microvascular disease. Finding this condition may require tests other than an angiogram. An angiogram is a kind of X-ray test. Doctors use it to look for a buildup of fatty plaque material that can block arteries. Arteries carry oxygen-rich blood away from the heart to the rest of the body. The World Health Organization says heart disease kills 18 million women a year. And these are not just older women. Carrie Vincent had a heart attack after giving birth to her first child at the age of 31. Ms. Vincent is now taking her message to women at meetings in their homes through an organization called Sister to Sister. Irene Pollan started Sister to Sister to educate women about heart disease. Ms. Pollan urges women to learn about their blood pressure, cholesterol levels, and other risk factors for heart disease. Ms. Pollan teamed up with a heart specialist at Brigham and Women's Hospital. Dr. Joanne Foody works mostly on prevention efforts. She says, "The good news is we know that 90% of heart disease is preventable by reducing risk. That means not smoking, and it means controlling or avoiding diabetes. It also means keeping a healthy weight and eating healthy foods. And it means exercising at least 30 minutes on most days and managing or reducing stress." Dr. Dariush Mozafarian at the Harvard School of Public Health also has other advice. He says people should eat more fish, whole grains, vegetables, vegetable oils, and nuts, and reduce the amount of salt and trans fats in their diets. Trans fats can increase the risk of heart disease. Heart disease increasingly affects women in developing countries. Dr. Mozafarian places a lot of blame on the global epidemic of obesity. He says people are getting chronic diseases not from eating too much, but eating poorly. And so, in fact, what they're not eating is actually probably mostly what's harming them. For VOA Special English, I'm Alex Villarreal.